Jessica Mlinaric is a writer, photographer, and marketer based in Chicago. Her work covering culture and travel has appeared in Condé Nast, Traveler, GQ, Chicago Magazine, The Architect's Newspaper, Chicagoist, and more. Jessica founded Urban Explorer in 2010 and shares stories about cities and their culture. She is, of course, also the author of the book that we are discussing tonight, Secret Chicago, The Weird, Wonderful, and Obscure. And with that, I'm going to pass off to Jessica. Thanks for being here, everybody.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. I'm excited to see so many people on the event tonight, especially people coming from all over the place. I guess that's one of the benefits of doing this virtually. So we can't wait to get back in person, but it's nice to be able to get people who aren't physically in Chicago to join. So I'm sharing my screen now. Okay. And hopefully everybody can see that. So thank you all for coming tonight, and to Jennifer and Arlington Heights Library for having me. I'm here live in my home office in the Wicker Park neighborhood of Chicago, and just glad that we could be together in some form tonight to share all these secret stories. I know that our travel plans are still being disrupted, but it's springtime and it's a great time to, you know, get around in our own backyards and do some exploring. So if you love Chicago, you are in the right place, and you're in the right place if you just like some weird stories. I've got plenty of those to share with you. So we have a lot of Chicago secrets to give up tonight, and I like to keep things interactive. So I'll do a little bit of reading, some trivia, and I definitely want to leave time for you to share any of your favorite secret places at the end. And if you are interested in learning more at the end, I'll have a code if you are interested in the book. And as Jennifer said, if you've got questions, put them in the chat and we will get those answered. So hopefully, no matter how long you lived here or if you're joining us from afar, there will be some surprises in store tonight. So I'm going to start off with just a couple frequently asked questions that I get about how I wrote the book. I am not from Chicago originally. So how did I get started writing about Chicago? Well, I grew up in Cleveland and I moved here to Chicago about 12 years ago now. I was so excited to be in a new place. And I was just, you know, going on walks and asking questions about the different things that I saw around me. And, you know, sometimes I'd ask my friends who are native Chicagoans if they knew the answer, and they might or they might not. And I would research those things on my own. And I started blogging about them on my own website and for some other publications around town. Eventually I had enough to fill a whole book. So you could say that I've been writing this since I got here, but the actual process took about a year. So a quick intro to the book. Here it is. It's got 90 places that are in and around Chicago. And it kind of looks like this. There's just, it's like a quick read and they're all in random order. So you can kind of pick it up and put it down as you like. And I've got some cool photos too. But it's places that are a little bit offbeat. So whether you have lived here forever or, you know, you're just visiting for the weekend, it's laid out like a bit of a scavenger hunt to a more hidden side of the city. My goal was to just tell stories that get people curious about visiting places that are new to them. So what did I consider a secret? I defined it as either somewhere that you might be familiar with, but you don't know there's a crazy backstory to it, or something that's actually hidden. How did I find all these places? Well, I did a lot of reading, so shout out to our libraries. And I just asked anyone that I encountered. So I got a lot of great ideas by talking to strangers. I would be at an art gallery or, you know, a friend's house, a concert, and just talk to the people around me. And I got tons of great ideas that way. Oh, I've got some Clevelanders on here. Awesome. Welcome, guys. So it was important to me to feature places all across the city. So I started by taking the places that I, you know, had written about and researched a little bit, and I put them on a map. And then I looked for the holes in the map, the places that I didn't know as much about. And I reached out to people in those communities. So I talked to historical societies, neighborhood leaders, bloggers. And when all else failed, I would just go to the bar and talk to the bartender because they're the secret keepers of the neighborhood. So got ideas from them too. Now, narrowing it down was not easy. You can imagine there are a lot of interesting stories to tell about the city. So I had a few criteria. I wanted each place to be accessible for readers to visit. So, you know, there are a few that you need an appointment for, but most you can just show up and check out. I wanted there to be something for people to look at, so you're not just showing up to an empty parking lot where a thing used to be. And I was hoping that even if you're familiar with the place, that I'm able to present a unique, interesting angle about it. So without further ado, let's jump into some of the secret spots. Okay. Normally I would give out candy to whoever answers these trivia questions correctly first, if we were in person from a place in the book, but since we are virtual, I'll ask you to put your answers to the trivia questions in the chat. And I'll read out your name if you get it first, and you can have bragging rights. So I'm actually going to read this first one because it's one of my favorites, but see if anyone gets this. Where is Chicago's smallest cemetery? Can see that it doesn't look like your average cemetery. Looks like somebody guessed by the Calumet River. Brian, that's true, very close. That's a bridge over the Calumet River that you see in the background. So we're right up on it. And I do love a map room for those of you mentioning it. This isn't a junkyard, specifically down at 93rd and Ewing. And if you can read the tombstone in the photo, you're not reading it wrong. It says that this individual was at the Battle of Waterloo. So how did he end up here on the south side? I am gonna read this one because it's such a good story. All right. Is a soldier's grave hidden in a south side scrapyard? A scrapyard on Chicago's southeast side isn't what you would call a peaceful resting place. Between the industrial setting and rusting machinery, it's the last place you'd want to spend eternity. Yet burial here was one man's last wish, and it's still honored today. Andreas von Zirngibel's story started far from Chicago. He was born in Bavaria in 1797, and he joined the Prussian army at age 18. He even helped defeat Napoleon at the Battle of Waterloo, where he lost an arm. Afterward, Andreas started a family and began a career as a fisherman. In 1854, he moved to the small town of Chicago with his wife and five children. He bought 40 acres of land along the Calumet River for $160 in gold. He settled there and resumed the fishing trade. Just a year after arriving in Chicago, he died of a fever. According to legend, his last wish was to be buried on his homestead. His family marked the grave with a wooden cross and they built a white picket fence around the grave. Although they moved to the north side, they continued to visit over the years. Decades later, the Calumet and Chicago Canal and Dock Company acquired the land. His relatives disputed ownership in the Illinois Supreme Court. The family claimed that the property deed was lost in the Great Chicago Fire, but the company ruled or claimed that he was a squatter. The court ruled that the company owned the land, but that the grave must remain intact, and the family was granted permanent access to the gravesite. Industry grew up around the former homestead. Today, concrete blocks mark the grave where a wooden cross once did. At about 100 square feet, it may be the city's smallest cemetery, but its caretakers over the years have honored his last wish. So this scrapyard is actually closed now, and the Southeast Historical Society does give tours of the property occasionally, not during COVID, But if you are on the Ewing Avenue Bridge, you can see these concrete blocks that surround it from the bridge. And they put those concrete barriers there to protect it because, unfortunately, when it was a working scrapyard, there's machinery moving around, the headstone was knocked over a few times. But now, since there's, you know, it's not an active yard, you can see there's some nature growing up a little bit around it, and maybe eventually it'll go back to looking like it did when Andreas lived there. Judy is mentioning the couch mausoleum in Lincoln Park. I do mention the couch mausoleum in my book. It is the only grave left in Lincoln Park that is visible because there are still plenty buried under the park that were never moved when they were supposed to be. And the reason it's in my book, there's a mystery about how many people are inside. They don't have any records. They don't know who's actually in there. So that's a fun one. All right. I feel like some people will know this one. What are the call letters for WLS 890 stand for? Brian and Kathy. Okay, lots of people. Well, those were the first two. Lots of people know that this is stands for the world's largest store. And what store are we talking about? Yeah, Kathy, Sears. So this is the Sears Tower, the first Sears Tower. Sears built their headquarters in North Lawndale in 1906. Part of that compound was a building that was the largest commercial building in the world at the time. And next to it, they built this tower. It was a 14-story tower that they called the Sears Tower. Now, WLS started broadcasting here in this tower from the 11th floor in 1924. Now, we know that Sears moved their headquarters downtown in the 70s to the building that we used to call the Sears Tower. So, now it's, well, it was the Willis Tower. I think there's somebody else is buying out the naming rights again, but if the one downtown is the old Sears Tower, that makes this one the old, old Sears Tower. It's now called the Nichols Tower, and it's been restored recently, and there are a lot of offices inside for nonprofit organizations, and they have an event space here on the top floor. I'll show you this photo. Is taken from that top floor event space. And you can see this great view looking east towards downtown. So you can see the old Sears Tower from the top of the old, old Sears Tower. You can see right here, it says Sears Roebuck and Company on the top. Okay, another piece of Chicago history. Do people know where the world's first nuclear reaction occurred? Kathy, Bill, Abby, Brian, Annie, Allie, I can't keep up. Okay, good. So we know that it occurred at the University of Chicago in 1942. It was part of the Manhattan Project, and it was under the football field on the old squash court. But where is that reactor located now? Does anyone know? It did not go too far. So Fermilab is a good guess. It's not there though. Looks like Rod, yes. Redgate Woods. So the reactor is buried in a Cook County Forest Preserve. It's around the Redgate Woods, part of the Forest Preserve, the Palos Preserve in Lamont. And this was once a top secret nuclear research facility. So they realized that they could not keep conducting research on nuclear experiments in the middle of a city at a university. So they went out here and they built Argonne. Now, this is not the same location that we know Argonne today. Argonne later moved, and when they decommissioned this first facility before they moved, they just took the reactors out in the woods and buried them. So there are two sites. There's a site with the reactors, two reactors, and then there's another site that has other just associated radioactive waste and, you know, lab materials or whatever. So that's pretty crazy. Looks like somebody said they used to work here and would go running because you can go walking around, running in the woods and stumble on these markers. And it's an incredible piece of world history just out in the woods, which is one of my favorites also. It's so crazy. Now they do conduct testing here on the radioactivity. In the 70s, I think there was a little bit of radioactivity, not enough to hurt anybody. But now they say it's pretty stable. And they think that it's just safer to keep everything buried than to move it somewhere else and dig it up and expose it. So the forest preserves are open. If you want to get out and get some fresh air, you might come across a surprise when you're hiking and you can hang out. But like the sign says, do not dig. Okay. Where can you see some priceless artworks by Maxfield Parrish, Mary Cassatt, and Grant Wood, and over 100 Chicago area artists for free? If you've been to our lovely downtown art museums, you know they're not free, so not talking about the Art Institute. The Union League Club, is that free? Okay, the Cultural Center is free, but that's not the one that I'm looking for here. The Historical Society is now the History Museum. They do charge admission. Smart Museum is down by University of Chicago. That's a lovely museum. It's not the Treehouse. Got some museum lovers in here. I love it. No, this is called the Vanderpool Art Collection. This is down in Beverly. It is in a Chicago Park District field house. It's named after an artist who lived in Beverly named John Vanderpool. And he was a professor at the School of the Art Institute. He was Georgia O'Keeffe's favorite art teacher. He also was a judge at the 1893 World's Fair. He was an art judge. When he died in 1911, his friends and admirers began donating works of art in his name. So all the artworks in this collection are donated, which is very cool. And the whole collection now resides in the Ridge Park Fieldhouse in Beverly. So, you know, on a normal day, you go in there, there's kids going to summer camp and they're playing basketball, whatever downstairs, just one floor up, there's this quiet gallery filled with all this beautiful, priceless art. They've got about 200 pieces on view. They've got even more in storage that they can't cram into this room. I don't believe that they are open currently during COVID, but when they are open, I really recommend it because the curator's name is Sydney and he knows the history of every piece and who donated it and what their connection to John Vanderpool was. And it's just like a very quirky thing that it's hidden in a Park District building. It's unexpected and it's very like quiet and inspiring in there. So I enjoy spots like that. All right. If anyone has ever told you to run away and join the circus, you can do that in Chicago. In Logan Square, there is a circus hidden in what kind of a building? Oh, Cheryl got it right away. Looks like Allie, Mark, and Jessica. Are you guys circus folk? This is in a church. It's called the Loft Circus Arts, and they offer classes in things like trapeze, aerial silks, and trampoline, all located in a building from 1908 that was an evangelical church. So it's been converted into a different kind of big top because you can see that the high ceilings of the church were perfect for all the kinds of rigging that's needed for this, you know, acrobatics. And even the bell tower was converted into a training space. So they have a two-year program if you want to become a circus professional. If you're more circus curious, you can take a $10 taster class just to see what kind of disciplines that they offer there. They normally offer a show once a month called Sanctuary where their students perform. I attended it in person a few years ago and it was amazing to see what people can do. But currently they do have some classes that are virtual. And you don't have to be, you know, an acrobat to do all of them. They have classes and things like stretching and clowning and headstands and magics, just some things that you can do at home, online, pick up a new skill. All right, we're going to head to the Loop. When improv legend Del Close died, he left behind a very personal effect that he bequeathed to the Men Theater. Looks like a few of you already know. Oh man, I didn't see who got it first. Who's the first one? I can't tell, but lots of people got this one right.
I think Kathy was first, so yay, okay. Kathy. Have some virtual candy.
Virtual candy, virtual claps. This is his skull. So if you don't know Del Close, he was a comedy legend. He was a mentor to the likes of Bill Murray and John Belushi. He passed away in 1999, and he left his skull to the theater in his will to be used as a prop in Hamlet or other productions that they might need a skull for. And so that's where it is now. It sits in the artistic director's office on a red velvet pillow in a lucite case. But there's a twist. A few years after his death, his business partner admitted that it wasn't really his skull. The hospital had refused her request to take it, even though it was his last wish. So she went down to a medical supply store and got another one. She even removed a few of the teeth to make it match up to the ones that Del was missing. So even though he, you know, it's not his skull in the office of the artistic director, it's somebody's. So I think he got the last laugh anyways. And if you're enjoying the presentation and you'd like to leave me any body parts, I will be happy to take cash instead. Thank you very much. Okay. And back to the circus. Showman's Rest is a burial plot built specifically for circus performers. And they've got animals guarding their graves. Does anyone know what kind of animal? Looks like Brian got it first. Somebody else said it is near them. A lot of people guessed elephants. You guys are fast. So this is located in Woodlawn Cemetery and is a burial plot. It's called Showman's Rest, built for circus and outdoor performers. It was put there by the Showman's League in 1917. The Showman's League was founded in Chicago. Their first president was Buffalo Bill, and they're still located here today. Just a year after they created this plot, unfortunately, they had to put it to use because there was a circus train accident in Hammond, Indiana, and as a result, 56 people were buried in this plot. Now, this was the early 1900s, so they didn't have everyone's employment records up to date, and some of these people were just day laborers helping out, or they might not know all their legal names. So some people were buried with names like their show names, nicknames like Baldy, or just unknown male or unknown female. And here's a photo of one of the elephant sculptures. There are five that surround the plot and watch over all of the departed performers. Their trunks are lowered in a sign of mourning. Now you can visit the cemetery. It is open if you'd like to get some fresh air. As a side note, I do recommend cemeteries during the pandemic as a great place to social distance because they're usually beautifully landscaped. There's some interesting architectural details and they're not very crowded. So it's a good place to do some walking. If you visit, you might hear some ghostly animal noises. Some people think that this is ghosts of, you know, the animals from the circus train. But there were no elephants actually buried here. So this is probably coming from the Brookfield Zoo, which is not too far away. I have been to an elephant graveyard in Arkansas, but that is a story for another day. Jessica says it's not crowded with the living anyways, so. All right, so we love our speakeasy themed places in Chicago. Where can you watch a show in an authentic Chicago speakeasy? Looks like M. Weber got it, Green Door Tavern. So the Drifter is a bar inside of the Green Door Tavern. And the Green Door's name refers to the Prohibition era practice of painting your door green to show that you're a speakeasy because you pay the green to operate as a speakeasy. The entrance to this bar, the Drifter, is hidden, But because you are all here, I will give you the secret. You enter the Green Door Tavern, you head downstairs, look around for the tchotchke cabinet. That's the doors behind there. All the decorations you see in this photo were found in the space. So after this was used as a speakeasy, they just used it for storage for a few decades. And they found all these cool wall hangings and bottles and flags and things in here, and they used that to decorate it. They also moved a water heater, and they tore down the drywall, and they found behind it a trap door where they would bring in the barrels from the alley down into the speakeasy. So that's pretty cool. So now this is a cocktail bar, and they print their cocktail menu on tarot cards, and they have about once an hour a show on their little stage, like acts like sword swallowing and magic and hula hoop burlesque, which was this photo. This is where I had my book launch party when the book came out. It's a small space, but very cool atmosphere. So somewhere to put on your list to visit when things are safe again. All right. In the 1890s, 60% of Chicago's streets were paved with what material? You can still find a few alleys in the city today. All right, lots of people knew about this one. This is wood block. So I'm gonna try something new tonight. I'm going to premiere this video that shows you the wood block alley. I hope that it will work out for everyone on your end with the internet. It's only about a minute long, so hopefully it's not too crazy, but let me know if it's not working for you. Let me just make sure I'm sharing my sound, okay.
I'm Jessica, author of Secret Chicago, and today we're going to explore Chicago's Woodblock Alley. Believe it or not, Chicago once paved its streets with wood, and there are a few places in the city where you can still check this out.
You might be surprised to know that in the 1890s, over half of Chicago's streets were paved with wood. The city began experimenting with a woodblock pavement known as Nicholson pavement in the 1850s. It was cheaper, cleaner, and quieter than stone, and it even held up pretty well against the Great Chicago Fire. While white oak and cedar were the most durable blocks, their lifespan was only about a decade. As nearby lumber was depleted and other methods became more affordable, woodblock pavement died out. There are still a few places in the city to see these wood-paved alleyways. This alley in the Lakeview neighborhood shows a lot of wear and tear. If you want to see the best example of woodblock paving in Chicago, head to the Gold Coast neighborhood. Start at the Archbishop's Mansion and walk to the alley behind it. It's between North State Parkway and North Astor Street. There's only one company that still manufactures wood blocks, and they used black locust pavers for this alley.
If you're wondering why this alley is in such great shape, it's because the local Gold Coast Neighborhood Association restored it in 2011 for $400,000. So we have them to thank for being able to walk in the footsteps of history today. Thanks for watching.
Thanks, guys. I'm glad it worked out. Hopefully everyone was able to see it. So I just thought it'd be fun to kind of show off the alley. It looks like Corey used to live near there. It's one that I really enjoy because it's kind of accessible anytime. If you're in the neighborhood, you can go check it out and walk through it. And thankfully that the Neighborhood Association was able to afford that $400,000 restoration bill for us to be able to enjoy it today. And it's just a beautiful neighborhood to walk around, lots of historic mansions and homes, and it's next to the park. So great place to go if you want a neighborhood walk in Chicago. So I mentioned that I did not grow up in Chicago, and when I was doing my research for the book, this is something that really surprised me. Chicago has the largest mass grave in the Western Hemisphere. Does anyone know where it is? Camp Douglas, Brian Guest, and Mark. That was the camp, but Lisa got the grave is actually in Oakwood Cemetery. So we know that there were no Civil War battles fought in Illinois, and that was surprising to me that Chicago was home to a Confederate prisoner of war camp. So Camp Douglas was located around where Bronzeville is today, and it started out as a training camp for Union soldiers. The land was donated by Senator Stephen Douglas, so Camp Douglas is named after him. But as the war dragged on and prison camps got overcrowded, they needed more camps to house people, so they started housing Confederates here. So it quickly got overcrowded. They had about twice as many people as it was built for. So the conditions were swampy, the sanitation was poor, and it earned the nickname 80 Acres of Hell. So not a great place to be. It was the deadliest Union Civil War camp. Now, 4,000 soldiers, Confederate soldiers, are buried in this mass grave in Oakwood Cemetery who died here. And just a few steps away, there are the graves of some Union soldiers who were guards at the camp. So it's an interesting juxtaposition to have these Confederate soldiers, all their names are on the monument, and then Union soldiers. And it's in a Black community with some very iconic Black leaders who are buried here as well, all in the same cemetery. So others in the cemetery are Jesse Owens, Ida B. Wells, Mayor Harold Washington, and Enrico Fermi, who worked on that nuclear reactor that we talked about earlier. So kind of a surprising piece of Civil War history right here in Chicago. Okay. Does anyone know what neighborhood artists credit an underground energy vortex for helping them get creative? This is Fulton Market. Fulton is a good guess. I'm not an underground energy vortex expert, so I am going to read this one as well. Before it was home to Chicago's trendiest restaurants, Fulton Market earned a reputation as an enclave for warehouse parties and creative types. Those in the know attribute the abundance of creative talent to something more than natural skills, a vortex. What is a vortex? According to Mars Gallery, it's a center of creative energy that many people feel vibrate through their bodies and minds. People and animals are drawn to vortices where energy exists on multiple dimensions and interacts with one's inner self. Vortex locations are usually reserved for Earth's mystical natural sites like Sedona. They're rarely found in urban settings. However, Mars Gallery is reportedly located over one of these energy vortex circles. This force lends a vibrational energy to the gallery and surrounding area. When I'm all by myself, I can almost feel a low frequency, says artist and gallery owner Peter Mars. Whatever is going on seems to stimulate creativity. A lot of the artists have commented on it. But don't take Peter's word for it. In 2002, the Chicago Journal hired a shaman to inspect the vortex. Parapsychologist Nabila Musa examined the gallery with a walking stick, tapping the floor and the walls. His findings confirmed an energy vortex near the back of the building. If you're interested in tapping into this well of creative energy, head to the alley near Mars Gallery's rear loading dock. You'll know you've reached the epicenter when you see spray paint on the street and a collection of tokens that artists and other visitors leave to thank the vortex. Whether or not you feel a rush of creativity after visiting the vortex, you're bound to get inspired by the many galleries and creative spaces nearby. So I went to the space to interview Peter Mars here, and he asked if I could feel the vortex. And I said, you know, I felt happy and content, and I didn't know if that was from the vortex or because I just had a big lunch. So you'll have to go and check it out yourself. Mars Gallery has moved though. They were there for 30 years and then the building was purchased. So they have relocated, but I'm very curious to know, do the new owners know about the vortex? Does it cost more in your lease or your mortgage to have a vortex on your property? Are they even aware? Are they going to find out? I'm very curious to talk to them. A three martini lunch, I wish. I don't think I'd get much done after that. All right, if you have a drink, time to raise a glass. I just have a water, but what Chicago brewery is powered by food waste? These are all good guesses. Goose Island, Mars. Oh, Jennifer got it. in the plant building. It's called Weiner Beer Company. It's located in the plant in the back of the yards neighborhood. And this is a former pork processing plant. And now it is a vertical farm and business incubator. And they focus on sustainable food production and energy consumption. So it used to be called Peer Foods. You can see it says Peer on the side of the building, and it did say it on top, and they very cleverly just flipped it around to show you what is in there now. They have about 20 sustainable small food businesses in here, and they've got a coffee company whose burlap sacks are used to grow microgreens. And the yeast and the wheat from the brewery are then used in bakery. And the whole space is working on being powered by an anaerobic digester. Now, this is a giant device, and you put organic waste in it. So the businesses who are there will donate the organic waste, as well as other partners around town. I believe Shed Aquarium has pledged to donate some waste. And that will help power this anaerobic digester, which will generate energy for the building. So they'll be able to power, different functions within the building using their own organic waste. It's a very cool space to tour. I'm not sure if they're currently offering tours again yet, but I would go check it out sometime and see how they've repurposed this building. You know, it used to do food production and now it does it again, but it's in a much more sustainable way. They do have farmers markets that are continuing now. So you can go check them out in person or online. You can purchase online and either pick them up or have things delivered to you. I am involved with a CSA that operates out of there. So in the winter I was getting veggies grown at different local farms and organized by the plant. And you can go check that out. But they've got a lot of businesses in there. There's gelato, kombucha, a cheese place, coffee shop, all kinds of great stuff to go and check out. So if you want to get very local food, I would recommend it. Somebody's mentioning Open House Chicago. Yes, that's like Christmas to me. It's one of my favorite events, and they have been there. I think the first time I ever visited the plant was during an Open House Chicago, but it's always changing. So I'd recommend if you've been, go back and see what they're doing now. There's also a museum opening there. It's going to be about the history of the stockyards and what the neighborhood is going to look like in the future. And they were supposed to be open already. They got delayed by the pandemic, but it should be open this year. It's called the Packing Town Museum. So here we are with another skull. The Museum of Surgical Science has the death mask of what infamous ruler? Pleasant House Bakery did used to be in the plant. It is located in the back of the yards neighborhood. Jessica got it. We've mentioned him once today. This is Napoleon. And this is his plaster cast made from his death mask in 1821. It's part of their fine art collection. Now, I was surprised to learn when I visited that the museum has fine art collection. They have a modern art collection related to surgical science. They've got beautiful paintings that illustrate medicine throughout history and a room of sculptures of famous scientists. They've got a library and manuscripts and letters from Florence Nightingale, all kinds of really interesting things that I wouldn't normally think of when you hear surgical science. But they do have very crazy things, instruments and tools that will make you appreciate modern healthcare. So they've got an iron lung. You could check out what that must have been like. And these ancient trephine skulls. So this is back when, if you had some pressure in your head to relieve it, they would drill a skull or a hole in your skull. So I'm very glad we can just take an aspirin today. Now, this is all housed inside a mansion in the Gold Coast. So it's just down the street from that woodblock alley, if you're making a day of it. It's the only mansion in the Gold Coast that is open to the public. And it was built by a socialite. She designed it to resemble Versailles. So you're walking around this museum. There's an old-timey apothecary on the first floor. And you're walking up like marble staircases, there's chandeliers, everything's really beautiful, and you're looking at old medical stuff. It's a unique experience, and I really recommend it. They have a great little gift shop too. Has anyone been here? What do you guys think about it? I think it's like unexpected. When you hear surgical science, kind of like, but it's a beautiful, fun place. All right. Music fans, did you know the Rolling Stones wrote a song and named it after a Chicago address? It's called 2120 South Michigan. And does anyone know what is at that address now? I'm going to play a little clip. It's not empty. You don't have to watch me dance. It's not the Checkerboard Lounge. I believe that building has been demolished, unfortunately. I wish that I could have seen it because I am a blues fan. This is called the Blues Heaven Foundation. And in the 1950s and 60s, it was home to the legendary rhythm and blues label Chess Records. Even if you don't know that name offhand, you probably know their songs because they had hits like Johnny Be Good and Etta James's At Last. The foundation was created by blues legend Willie Dixon. He was a musician here for many, many years. He created it to preserve the blues music's legacy and to get royalties for the artists. So you can tour the building today. There's a museum and you can learn about Chicago's blues history and see the Perfect Sound Studio. That's what Keith Richards called their studio. It's still intact there. Now, when I came to visit, there were people from all over the world who come to America and they're music fans and they pilgrimage to all the famous music sites, you know, like Nashville, studios in New York, and they come to Chicago to see Chess Records. There were people from Hungary, the Netherlands, and the UK when I was on a tour, and I was the only person from Chicago. So I think it's a really, I don't know, it's not as well known in Chicago, or it's not as appreciated. And if you're a music fan, it's very cool to see. In the summer, there's a little garden right next door, and they do a free concert one day a week. I'm not sure what they're going to be doing this summer, but that's something to look out for. And I think I've heard that there might be another blues museum opening in the Loop, which is great. I'm a museum fan, but I just think there's something about getting to go to the building and see where this actually happened. When I was on my tour, one of the women was a singer and she asked if she could sing a song in the space. And that was really powerful to get to witness like music happening in this legendary music space. So I would recommend checking it out whenever it is safe to do. All right, sports fans. Bohemian National Cemetery has a final resting place for which fans? Janet, Megan, Robert, Cheryl. It's the Cubs. I think we're actually gonna get a real baseball season this year, so that's good news. This is located 5 miles north of Wrigleyville. It's a plot called Beyond the Vines, built especially for Cubs fans, by a Cubs fan. It's got a columbarium here, which is a fancy word for burial wall with space for 288 urns. Or if you prefer to be buried in the ground, they have spots for that too. And it's got a bullpen bench, stadium seats, home plate, turf, and dirt, all from Wrigley Field. So all that stuff actually came from Wrigley. You can see that people leave ticket stubs and baseball cards for their loved ones. And it was built by a fan because he wanted to make the experience of visiting loved ones, I don't want to say more fun, but maybe focused on the good memories that you had and less sad. So if Wrigley is your second home in life, this might be a good place for your afterlife. Okay, does anyone recognize where this is? It's in a museum. It's a historic room in a museum. Brian is on it. And Allie, Megan, Denise, Mark, Diane. Okay. So this is at the Art Institute. Now I know the Art Institute is not a secret. It is one of the most popular tourist destinations in Chicago, but hear me out. I think that within the Art Institute, this is the Chicago Stock Exchange Trading Room. I think that this is a hidden gem in the Art Institute. I'm a member of the Art Institute, and it took me, I think, years before I stumbled on this room. It is open to the public, but it's kind of tucked away in a corner. You have to go down a step to get to it, and the doors are closed on it. Now, they're not locked. You can open them and enter into it, but I think it's not so obvious that it's the space that's inviting you in to visit. It looks like it's just an office or something that you're not supposed to go into. But it was originally built by the famous architectural team of Louis Sullivan and Dagmar Adler in 1894. And it was slated for demolition in the 70s when Chicago was losing a lot of its historic buildings, unfortunately. So many preservationists were trying to salvage these historic buildings around town. And Richard Nichols was one of them. He was a photographer who helped document all these spaces before they were lost. And he did some salvaging of architectural treasures. Unfortunately, he died in an accident at the demolition site when he was there photographing it. So he never lived to see this room reconstructed, but the Art Institute did preserve it, reconstruct it, and they restored all the craftsmanship. So when you're in here, you can admire all of the beautiful stenciling, all the colors, all the stained glass, because they've all been restored. Some people are saying that it's very open. There's usually nobody in there. I think maybe there's been one other person when I've gone in here. And I really love this space because you're in a bustling museum, you're steps away from Michigan Avenue, you're wandering around the Art Institute. And I just love to go in here and kind of take a breath. It's usually empty and take in the details and just kind of be in the quiet for a moment. It's one of my favorite spaces in Chicago. And somebody mentioned, yes, they do rent it out for events. So if you can afford that, that would be beautiful. So next time you're at the Art Institute, look out for this space because it's usually pretty private and you can enjoy it kind of all to yourself. All right, I'd love to see people put their guesses for this one in the chat. How many terminals are at O'Hare? I'm seeing 5, 4, 6, 4, 5, 6. Okay, I'm seeing 4, 5, 6, 7, 15, 7, 9. Good guesses. The answer is 4, but they're numbered 1, 2, 3, and 5. So there is no terminal 4. You might not have ever noticed this because you're kind of just looking for your own terminal that you have to go to board your flight. So you might not even realize when you look at the sign that there's not a 4, but there did used to be a 4. And when they built a new international terminal in the late 80s, they renamed it number 5 because they didn't want to confuse people who were used to 4 where it was, and then they get confused and go there when they're supposed to go to the new 4. So they just called it 5. I don't know if that's less confusing. You can see a hint of where 4 used to be. If you walk in and you're getting off the train and you go and you see this sign, you take a left. And before you get on the moving walkway, if you look to your left again, there's a sign for elevator center 4. This just goes up to a bus terminal where terminal 4 used to be. So it's nothing very exciting, but if you're a nerd like me, I see it and I like chuckle to myself that that's where terminal 4 used to be. I know there is some construction going on at O'Hare now, and I don't know if there's gonna be a new terminal. And if there is, like, what are they gonna number it? Are they gonna call it 4? Are they gonna skip that? Are they gonna just pick a random number like 9? I don't know. If you have any intel on the O'Hare construction, please let us know. All right, just a couple left. Here's a spooky one. West Chicagoland Cemetery is home to a woman whose body was exhumed after her mother had nightmares that she was buried alive. It's quite a story. Ruth got it. Candy for Ruth. She knew that right away. This is Mount Carmel. Now, this woman's name was Julia Bucola. She died in childbirth in 1920, and she was buried in her wedding gown. So she was nicknamed the Italian Bride. A few months after she was buried, her mother, Filomena, started having nightmares that her daughter was buried alive. And she wanted to exhume the body. And everyone said, I'm so sorry for your loss. You know, you must be very tired. Get some rest. Like, we're not going to exhume the body. And time goes on, and she's still having nightmares. So she tries again, and everyone's like, okay, it's been a while now. We're not going to exhume the body. Give it a rest. And she keeps going for 7 years. Can you imagine what having nightmares for 7 years must have felt like? Doesn't sound very nice. So finally, everyone was tired of hearing about it, and she succeeded. And they exhumed her. And when they did, the results shocked everyone, because although the coffin had signs of decomposition, Julia's body appeared to be perfectly preserved. So they took this, the community took this as a sign from God, and they built this lavish marble sculpture at her grave when they reinterred her. And the sculpture is based on her wedding photograph. And I don't know if you can see here, but there are two photos mounted to this monument. The top one is her in her wedding dress, and the bottom is Julia on the day she was exhumed. So this is my photo of the photo on the monument, which is her at her exhumation. And I don't know if you can see, her skin does look pretty good. You can go see it for yourself and be the judge of whether or not, you know, this was a miraculous sign. But, you know, after 7 years, it's not bad. So there's a high school across the street, and students have reported seeing a woman in white walking through the cemetery at night. So perhaps she never did go back into the ground after all. Has anyone, okay, I see some people talking about the ghost. Has anyone, did you go to school there, that school across from Mount Carmel? Have you seen the ghost? Let me know. All right, last one. I know we're running out of time. Where is the world's tallest church? It is downtown. It is a Methodist church. It is a Chicago temple. These are all right. It's the First United Methodist Church of Chicago. It's located in the Loop. You might recognize it now because you can see it's right next to Daly Plaza. And the congregation actually started before Chicago was even a city back in 1831. Their first church was across the river in a log cabin. So they've upgraded. In 1924, they built this Gothic skyscraper on prime real estate downtown. And the Sky Chapel is located in an old bell tower way up on the 27th floor. So it is 568 feet above street level. And to get up to that chapel, you have to take a set of stairs and two elevators to get all the way up there. It was the chapel was built by the Walgreen family. Now, this is prime location downtown, right by all the courts and government buildings. So the church very wisely rents out a lot of the space. They don't need this whole building for their church functions. They've got a regular church on the first floor, and they've got offices. I believe the pastor lives in an apartment here, and they've got the Sky Chapel, but they rent out a lot of space in here to people who work downtown. So it is the tallest place of worship above street level. But in Germany, there's a building called Ulmminster, and they are only 530 feet above street level, but they claim that they are the tallest building entirely devoted to religious purposes, because ours is not entirely religious. So either way, it's a great view, and the congregation very kindly welcomes people in, and they do a free tour, I believe, every day in normal times. I don't know about right now during the pandemic, but I think it's very, very nice that they have this unique space and that they invite other people to come and check it out. So you can look out for that when, you know, things are a little more normal. All right, so I mentioned that I learned a lot of great secret places from other people. So I would love to hear your favorite secret places, your questions also, but if you've got a favorite secret spot around Chicago, please let me know, drop it in the chat. And if you'd like to check out the book, you can find it at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, your local bookshop, or you can order it from me at this website, secretchicagobook.com. I've got a little discount as a thank you. And this is also where you can sign up for my newsletter, follow me on social media, email me, all that good stuff. So any questions, any secret spots you want to share? Ooh, okay, somebody says the Green Mill is in the Uptown area. Did it have green in its name to designate it as a speakeasy? I don't believe so. The Green Mill predates Prohibition. It was built in the 19 teens, I think. And it was built right next to, is that Graceland Cemetery over there? And it was kind of a stopover for people after they would go and bury people in the cemetery. They'd all go over to the Green Mill and have a drink. And then there used to be some movie filming in Chicago during that time. And a lot of the movie stars like Gloria Swanson would go and hang out there and drink too. So I think the Green Mill's name predates that practice. That's a great question. Let's see, what else do we have here? The website is, that's my blog, urbanexplorer.com, but there's no A in urban because that name was taken. U-R-B-N Explorer. Secret Chicago Book also is where the book is. You can try either one of those. They're both linked. The Marquette Building mosaics, oh, those are beautiful. I think those are Tiffany glass, if I'm not mistaken. I should do a book on the suburbs. I do have about 8 or 10 places in the suburbs in this book. So I do have some outside of the city of Chicago proper, but because I'm not from here, I love getting out and exploring and learning more about the suburbs. So tell me your favorite spots. See, Cultural Center, yes, another gorgeous Tiffany mosaic. Riding the L to explore the city, yes, that's a great idea. I love just getting on the Brown Line and getting to see the downtown views. Beverly Castle, yes. It's a church also. Movie stars had suites at the Edgewater Beach. Yes, the apartment building is still there. Where did I grow up? I grew up just south of Cleveland. So it's a small town called Walton Hills. The Lithuanian Museum. I have not been there yet, but one of my new projects is to go to all the cultural museums in the city. So I will be checking that out. The Eastland plaque along the river. Yes, that is a tragedy. And the victims of it are buried in the same cemetery as the Cubs burial site, Cubs fan burial site, I should say. Let's see, mini golf in a funeral home. I have been there. I wrote about that for a magazine. That is in Palatine. And I don't know about right now, but they normally do open their mini golf in the basement of their funeral home to the public. It's called Algrim Acres. Favorite secret places in Cleveland. Let's see. Well, there's the Heinen's Building downtown. It's now a grocery store, but it was formerly a bank that has a big, beautiful stained glass ceiling, kind of like our cultural center in Chicago. And I just really love the cultural gardens in Cleveland. It's a drive with these gardens on either side and all of the different ethnic communities donated to put their own garden there. It's beautiful to walk around. San Filippo Estate, I've not been to yet. I was in Chicago when the Cubs beat the Indians. I was one of three people in the bar rooting for the Indians. But you know, the Cavs won a championship that year and Cleveland's not really used to winning things that much. So I think, I don't know how they would have handled two championships. So I'm happy for Chicago. Square Heel Shoes. I've heard of this. I did not know that they have a museum. That is fantastic. You guys are coming up with some great stuff. Tribune Tower stones are in the book, kind of the origin story of how they got there. The Copernicus Center, I have not been inside, but it looks very beautiful. What's Kung Shlong? I don't know what that means, Paul. Can you let us know what that is? I'm not familiar. Let's see. Oh, I'm like behind. You guys are so fast. Downers Grove has a cemetery downtown on Main Street. Our Lady of Angels. Is that the one in Bucktown? That's pretty close to me if that's the one you're talking about. Or is that the one in Downers Grove? Thanks, you guys. This is awesome. Well, anyways, thank you so much for joining me tonight, for taking the time and sharing all of your stories and playing trivia with me. One of the things that I learned about Chicago when I was writing this book was just how weird and fascinating and fun it is. And there's so many great stories. So hopefully we can all get out and enjoy the city again soon. Please stay safe and healthy, and let's get back to exploring Chicago.
Jessica, thank you so much. This was really fantastic. And thanks everybody for all of the great interaction and chat, all of the good guesses, I hope you all enjoyed your virtual candy. Everybody earned it. And we'd love to have you again in person, you know, when we can do this in a room and throw that candy out there. Let's try and do it again, because you've got so many more fascinating spots in the book, and it'll give everybody else an opportunity to share theirs. So,
I do have a new project that I'm starting now. It's going to be kind of a scavenger hunt theme. So I'm working on that now. So hopefully I can come back. Oh, and I should mention, I am going to be on WTTW on the 16th at 8 o'clock. On a quiz show. So I'm going to be the one being quizzed. It's hosted by Jeffrey Bear, if you guys know him.
That's great. I hope that he doesn't stump you. Do you know a date that we can tune in?
It is this April 16th. So okay. That's the day that I'm going to be on.
Okay. To everybody who's here, I will put that date into the email that I send as a reminder that you can catch Jessica on Jeffrey Bear's show on April 16th. And we will send you an email to thank you with the survey. There will also be a survey that pops up when you leave today if you would prefer to just do it right now and get it out of the way. We always love to hear your feedback, and it's going to ask what other types of programs we can offer for you too. So please do tell us. Everything's changing all the time right now. Jessica, this was just the right thing for going into spring. It's getting everybody inspired to get out and see some new things. So thank you.
Thank you all for spending the time tonight.
Absolutely. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.